So I'm going to speak in English. I speak a bit German, but not enough to do this presentation. I'm Peter Paul Koch from Amsterdam. I test browsers so you don't have to at quirksmode.org. Those of you who work with browsers on a daily basis will know that site. And today is the last time I'm going to give my viewports presentation, which I've been doing all this year long for a specific reason I will come to later in this presentation. But what I really am secretly going to teach you is why responsive design works. Not how, you already know how, but why does it work? Why is that specific combination of a meta viewport and a media query, why is it working and why does it work on all browsers? That's what I'm going to try to explain to you today. But before we start actually talking about viewports, plural, because there's three viewports on mobile browsers instead of one on the desktop browsers, before we're going to talk about that, I need to say a few words about pixels. Because a pixel is not a pixel. That is, secretly, you as a web developer are already using two kinds of pixels, CSS pixels and device pixels. And that may sound complicated at first sight, but it's not, because you already know what you're doing, you already know what they are, you just don't realize you know it. So, what are these two pixels? We will talk first about CSS pixels, because they're by far the most important, and it's really simple, they are the pixels you use in CSS. How many of you write CSS on almost daily basis? Quite a few. Okay, so if you use pixels in CSS, you use CSS pixels. With 190 pixels, padding left 20 pixels, whatever, it's CSS pixels. And it's best to see them as an abstract construct. They do not actually have anything to do with the physical pixels that are on the screen of this device or that device or any device you have. Their size increases or decreases when the user zooms. That may sound complicated as well, but we'll get back to that in a moment. This is, in fact, one of the reasons that CSS pixels have to exist, because you have to give the user a way of zooming in on your website. On mobile, certainly, but also on desktop. Okay, let's take a look at the example site. This is a really existing site. It's of the Mobilism Conference me and some other people are organizing in Amsterdam. And it's about the mobile web, so of course it's a properly responsive site. But for most of this presentation, we're going to pretend that it's not, because that will teach you a lot about why responsive design is necessary and why mobile browsers have taken certain choices, have made certain choices. On this website, we have a left menu, and it's 190 pixels wide. That's just hard-coded in the CSS, nothing special, 190 CSS pixels. What we're going to do now is zoom in on this site. And this happens, not surprisingly. The point I want to make here is that this menu, although it has grown larger, is still 190 pixels wide. Because what has happened is that every individual CSS pixel has stretched up a bit when we zoomed in. So the menu is still 190 CSS pixels wide, and that's going on all the time when you zoom both on mobile and on desktop. You don't even realize it anymore. We have become so very used to zooming. But this is actually the underlying mechanism. You increase or decrease the size of your CSS pixels. And because your entire style sheet is written in CSS pixels, the entire layout of your site just stretches or decreases in size. Okay, device pixels are even simpler. They are the physical pixels on the device. This particular device and any device you have in your possession has a specific pixel count, horizontal and vertical, and nothing can change that, because that's just hardware, right? You cannot increase or decrease the number of or the size of device pixels, because it's just the smallest unit that can take on a certain color on your screen. The best known example of device pixels and CSS pixels is the iPhone. This is the old iPhone 3G, something like that, and it had 320 device pixels. Which meant that when you show a website in a hypothetical 100% zoom, one CSS pixel will be exactly equal to one device pixel. That was by design, of course, that's not a coincidence. But then the newer iPhone, the 4S, or the 4, I can't remember which one, it got double the amount of device pixels. There were twice as many pixels on the device, but that meant that the CSS pixels now took 4 device pixels, 2 by 2. That was actually good because it allowed the device to use subtle gradients in, for instance, photos or stuff like that, and it all looked crisper. This was exactly the reason why Apple created a Retina screen, to allow more device pixels per CSS pixels. If this sounds pretty theoretical to you, don't worry, we'll get more practical later on. So in practice, what kind of pixels are you using on your sites and in your web development work? In general, CSS pixels. There's just one single exception to that, and that is screen.width, the JavaScript screen.width property, and that is a very serious problem. In fact, the most serious problem I'm going to treat in this presentation, and we'll talk about it later. Okay, with that introduction out of the way, let's go to the actual viewports. Again, our example site. Our example site has a container div, which has a padding left of 34%. So that this actual main content takes only 66% of the screen. I'm going to teach you a little trick now in CSS. As soon as you see a percentage anywhere in CSS, always ask yourself, percentage of what? Because that will teach you something about how CSS works. So let's ask it now, 34% of what? You all know the answer, it's 34% of the browser window. But why is that the case? A general CSS rule is that if you use percentual widths, 34%, 68%, 27%, whatever, that width is calculated relative to the container element of whatever you're talking about. In this case, we're talking about a div that's a child of the body. So the 34% is calculated relative to the width of the body of the website. Which raises the question, what is the width of the body? Another fundamental CSS rule, every single block level element, including the HTML and body tags, has an implicit width of 100%. If you do nothing, every block level element will stretch 100% of the browser window. You know that. But 100% of what are we talking about here? We get 34% of the body width of 100%, and the body width in turn is calculated relative to the width of the HTML element, which is the topmost element in any website. And the width of the HTML element is again 100%. I'm hoping you start to see the problem here, because we're going up a tree 100%, 100%, 100%. In the end, we need an absolute fixed value. And providing that value is the task of the viewport. The HTML element's width is calculated relative to the viewport. In the CSS specification, it's called the initial containing block. It's just a different name for the viewport. And on desktop, the viewport is equal to the browser window. So if I say the HTML element has a width of 100%, that means 100% of the browser window. You already knew that, but I need to split it out in all these steps in order for you to understand what's going on mobile, because it's much more complicated on mobile. So on desktop, that 34% we saw just now is eventually calculated relative to the viewport, which is the same as the browser window. And on mobile, it's a lot more complicated. That's good, because I earn my money by explaining this kind of complicated stuff. So I'm happy with that. Please do not make it simpler. Make it more complex. As I said, when you zoom in, you enlarge the CSS pixels. And the result of that is that less of them fit on the screen and the viewport becomes smaller. This may be slightly counterintuitive, but it's something that's happening all the time. Again, we take a look at the website, and the viewport is now roughly 720 pixels wide. That's because of the way I took that screenshot. It's nothing fundamental. Now we're going to zoom in again on the website, which means that all individual CSS pixels grow larger, which means that less of them fit in the browser window, which means that the viewport becomes about 580 pixels. That is what's going on desktop when you zoom in on a website. You make the viewport smaller. And that can have all kinds of consequences. All the CSS percentages are recalculated, etc., etc. This is, I hope, something you actually test in your websites, right? You should always zoom in and out a little bit and see how your CSS layout behaves. Never assume that all users will use your website on zoom level 100%. Certainly not on mobile. Okay. As I said, on mobile it's quite a bit more complicated. Before I explain how, you have to realize the fundamental problem mobile browser vendors had back in 2007, 2008. The original iPhone came out. Nokia and BlackBerry started to understand that they had to do had to become serious about browsing. Google was working on Android, and they all needed browsers. Because browsing was considered a key feature of a smartphone platform. The problem back then was that there were no mobile optimized sites yet. In the 10 years before, all web developers thought, okay, our users will have at least a monitor of 1024 and maybe more. Well, maybe sometimes 800 pixels, but especially in the later years, we didn't really like 800 pixels anymore. It was so small and you couldn't do all kinds of stuff. So we said, no, 1024. Of course, a mobile phone has far less space than that. But still, a mobile browser had to show these desktop-optimized sites of 1024 pixels wide, had to show that okay-ish on a small mobile screen. And that was the fundamental problem the browser vendors had. Again, the website with the padding left of 34% and a width of 190 pixels. Now we're going to switch over to a mobile view, and we are going to pretend that a mobile browser behaves exactly as a desktop browser, and we get this. This would be the result if we would literally translate the concept of viewport from the desktop to mobile, and this is of course horrible. This is not what you want to show your people when you are saying you are working on the next generation platform. They want to see something sensible. So the mobile browser vendors were forced to change the viewport. They could not literally copy viewport equals browser window width from the desktop. So they changed the rules. They said that by default, their viewport would be 768 to 1024 pixels wide, depends on the browser, and 980 pixels, iPhone, is by now the most common value. This is what we call the layout viewport, and there are three mobile viewports, and of them the layout viewport is by far the most important one. I'm going to get back to the layout viewport over and over again in this presentation. The layout viewport serves to constrain your CSS layout. If you say padding left 34%, that 34% is relative to the layout viewport. And what we're doing here on a mobile device is making that layout viewport way wider than the screen. That was necessary because a desktop-optimized website requires something light, like 950 to 1024 pixels. And the result of that was that it will stretch out of the browser window on a mobile device. Responsive design, at its basis, is the art of overriding the default width of the layout viewport. I'll get back to that. Okay, so this is the layout viewport. Well, this is not a real screenshot from a real mobile device, but it comes close enough. The layout viewport is now way wider than the screen. And again, that is deliberate, so that the layout of the site, the entire CSS layout that a desktop-only web guy had thought of, would show up at least decently on a mobile device. It's not great, it's not a mobile experience, but it's the least bad thing they could do back in the early days when there were no mobile optimized sites yet. Because the website is now way wider than the mobile screen, we need a second viewport to define what the user is actually seeing. Because there are a few CSS declarations, especially position fixed, that depend on what the user is currently seeing. And this leads to the visual viewport, which is the second of the three mobile viewports. And it's basically this. It's just the width of the screen. However, it's the width in CSS pixels. That is, if you zoom in and you make your CSS pixels larger, again, less of them fit on the screen, and the visual viewport will become smaller, just like we saw on desktop earlier. However, and that's the big difference between mobile and desktop, the layout viewport does not change size. Right? If you zoom in, everything becomes bigger. And you don't get that suddenly everything starts to change and your whole layout starts to be rearranged, etc., etc. Because this width, again, in CSS pixels, does not change. That's, of course, totally deliberate, because changing the layout of your entire page means recalculating the entire page, means sending all kinds of commands to the browser, and that they have to switch this and that and change that, and maybe some media queries kick in. That all takes way too much energy. Because especially Apple and Nokia, and to a lesser extent BlackBerry and Google, were concerned with battery charge in a mobile phone. If you do too many things in websites, if every single thing the user does results in a complicated recalculation of the entire website, your battery will drain earlier, and they didn't want that. Okay, again an example. Say that the layout viewport is this nice painting of a nice lady. And on the desktop, you of course see the entire picture. On mobile, however, we're not looking at this entire picture, we're peeping at it through a keyhole, and that keyhole is the visual viewport. Of course, the mobile browser tries to help us because the keyhole can move and it can increase and decrease in size. But it remains a keyhole. In the end, a desktop-optimized site will not work really well on mobile. And the browser vendors knew that, but they couldn't help it. They had to teach us web developers how to create proper mobile sites. Quick detour to JavaScript. You can read out a layout viewport with document element client width and client height, and it works everywhere. And when I say everywhere, I mean on all the 50 browsers I tested. I tested this thoroughly. Because, especially 3 years ago when I started these tests, I thought it can't be that easy. It can't be that there's just one JavaScript property that works across all of the, I don't know how many mobile browsers. Turned out that yes, it was that easy. It works almost everywhere. I'm not sure whether it's almost there. I think it works absolutely everywhere. Well, not on UC Mini, which is a weird browser that I'm not going to go into. If you see UC Mini here, you go there and you ignore it completely. Okay, visual viewport is window inner width and window inner height, and it does not work in Android 2. So what, we say nowadays, how much market share does Android 2 have nowadays? It doesn't work in Opera Mini for fundamental reasons I'm not going to go into today, and it also doesn't work in UC8. You know the UC browser, right? Who knows the UC browser here? Ah, a few, good. UC is the most important browser in China. It's WebKit-based. UC8 was a weird browser. Never ever touch UC8, but UC9 and 10 are actually pretty decent browsers. And UC is starting to expand in the developing world, for instance, in India and Indonesia. And maybe it'll even come to Europe. They want to, but we Europeans are used to other kinds of browsers. Never mind. That's another story and another presentation. So, what we have seen so far is that there's one viewport on the desktop, and that viewport both serves to constrain your CSS layout, to tell your CSS, okay, this is the amount of space you have, and it also defines what the user is currently seeing. On mobile, these two functions have been split. The layout viewport tells the CSS how much space it has, and the visual viewport defines what the user is currently seeing. Okay, that's understandable. However, there's a third mobile viewport, a viewport that has no equivalent on the desktop, and I call it the ideal viewport. By the way, this is totally my own name for this thing, because nobody else has ever talked about this. I mean, everything I show in this presentation, I have been testing, I think actually since early 2010, to get an understanding of what browsers are doing with the viewports. And in the process, I had to invent some names, among which the ideal viewport. So, what is the ideal viewport? When an actual mobile browser downloads an actual desktop optimized website, you get roughly something like this. What mobile browsers usually do is they zoom out as much as possible in order to give the user an overview of the site. The text is now unreadable. Well, maybe except for the headline here and the logo here, but the rest of the text you absolutely cannot read. But at least you can kind of see, oh, there's the main navigation there, and there's the main content there, and there's some speaker photos there, and you can zoom in on whatever you want to see. This is not an ideal solution, but it's the least bad thing mobile browsers can do to a desktop website. However, what they want to do, of course, is to create a website that has the perfect width for the device it's being viewed on, so that the user does not have to start zooming in and panning the website and can actually read the text as soon as he arrives at the website. And that is what the ideal viewport is all about. Basically, the ideal viewport is just a width and a height hidden somewhere in the browser. And that width and height tell you, okay, if you want to give the user a nice experience on this particular device, you have to use this width and height for your layout viewport. You have to set the width and height of the layout viewport to the ideal viewport. And then you get this. If this sounds abstract to you, I will give you a concrete example later on. So far in this presentation, I have been using the BlackBerry Z10 as my example device for two reasons. First of all, to remind everyone that there's more than just iPhone and Android. Not much more, but there's still more BlackBerry and Windows Phone. And secondly, because it has a slightly odd ideal viewport of 342 by 570 pixels. If you use the iPhone, which used to have just 320 and 480 and later, what was it, 568 or something, these numbers may seem weird. But they're not wrong. In fact, when I test websites on the BlackBerry Z10, it turns out that this ideal viewport works pretty well on the specific device. And that's what it's all about. The ideal viewport doesn't have a specific value. It has a value for each and every different device. And it should enable you, as a consumer of mobile websites, to see the ideal website on the specific device you are using. That is the task of the ideal viewport. But there are weird values, yes, I do admit that. We'll see a few more. Okay, there used to be one extra advantage to the ideal viewport, which is that it kind of covers over device differences for you. And the prime example used to be the iPhone. We had the old iPhone 3G, and we saw that it had 320 device pixels. Its ideal viewport was also 320 pixels, which means the ideal size of a site on the iPhone is 320 pixels. Along came the iPhone 4S, and it doubled the number of device pixels, but the ideal viewport stayed the same. 320 was still the ideal size for a website on an iPhone, and that is understandable because the actual physical dimensions of the iPhone did not change from 3 to 4. It stayed the same number of centimeters, it just added more pixels. But 320 pixels was still the ideal way of viewing a site roughly at this distance when you try to browse mobily. Of course, then stuff started to change. Since 2007, Apple had stuck with 320 pixels for the ideal viewport, but now on the iPhone 6 it's 375 pixels, and on the iPhone 6 Plus it's 414 pixels. This took quite a few people by surprise, but I'm very glad that Apple did it, because the problem with the 320 pixels was not so much the 320 pixels itself, but the fact that everybody started to copy Apple, whether that made sense for their device or not. We will see an example of that later on in this presentation. Apple has such a huge mind share of web developers that everybody thought, especially in the early days of mobile web development, oh yeah, mobile web development, that's like 320 pixels, right? So it works on the iPhone, so everything's right. No, it's not. There's more than just the iPhone. People refuse to see it, but now they are forced to, because the newest iPhone do not work with 320 anymore, but with 375 and 440 pixels. Again, these are not wrong numbers. They just surprise me personally. It makes total sense to say that if you have a slightly wider iPhone, the ideal viewport should also become slightly wider. And if you have an even bigger iPhone, the ideal viewport should become even bigger. Quick detour to JavaScript. Can you read out the ideal viewport? No, you cannot. Here we come to the screen.width and screen.height problem. On some browsers, screen.width and screen.height give you the size of the ideal viewport. On other browsers, on other browsers, screen width and screen height give you the number of device pixels on the screen, which is a totally different metric that we are web developers are not interested in. Even worse, you don't know what you will get. Even worse, I don't know if you use Google Analytics or any kind of package that measures visits your website. You usually have a nice kind of graph where you can see, okay, what kind of resolutions are these people using? Those numbers are completely unreliable because they all are being gathered by reading out screen.width and screen.height, which can mean two different things. If you see 1260 by 1080 Android, and in the next entry you see a 480 by 360 Android, it's actually the same phone, just with a different browser. Because Chrome uses this definition, but Android WebKit, the old Android browser, uses this definition. So it may actually be the same phone, even though it reports two wildly different resolutions. So do not trust any resolution statistics anywhere on the web. Even worse, this problem is spreading to desktop. So far, all desktop browsers use this definition, but that is starting to change now in ways I don't quite understand yet and certainly don't agree with. So screen.width and screen.height are fundamentally unreliable and you should never ever use them in your sites. Okay, so we have talked about the ideal viewport. We have talked about the layout viewport, and I've kind of let slip that the idea of responsive design is setting the width of the layout viewport, which by default is 768 to 1024, to the ideal viewport. And then you get a website that works perfectly on the device you're currently using. How do you do that? By using the meta viewport tag. Most of you will already have guessed that. This is the meta viewport tag with content width equals device width. And it does exactly what I said just now. It sets the dimensions of the layout viewport, which serves to constrain your CSS, to the ideal viewport, which is the ideal dimension for the specific device you're currently watching the website on. So by default, the layout viewport is between 768 and 1024. By using the meta viewport tag, you can set the layout viewport to a value of your choice. You can actually set it to a specific a pixel value. You can say width equals 400, if you like. But 95% of the time, that's not what we want. Instead, we want to use the device width keyword that sets it to the ideal viewport. So this is what's actually going on in the bowels of the browser when you use the meta viewport tag. You set the layout viewport to the ideal viewport, and as a result, you get a website that has the ideal width for the device the user is using. Even better, you as a web developer don't have to know exactly what that width is. The browser will figure it out for you. I'm kind of assuming that this does not come as a huge surprise to most of you, especially not when you've worked a bit with responsive design, but I'm hoping that the next slide will surprise you, because there's a second way of doing exactly the same. And that way is this. Initial scale equals one. Now, in theory, scale is Apple talk for Zoom. I don't know why they call it scale, if a normal person calls it Zoom. But initial scale, in theory, gives the initial Zoom level of the site, where 1 equals 100%. Do you remember the trick I taught you at the start of this presentation? You see a percentage, somewhere having something vaguely to do with CSS, ask yourself, percentage of what? 100% of what? It turns out that it's not the visual viewport. It's not the layout viewport either. It's 100% of the ideal viewport. That is, the browser does not really care what real zooming factor you have. Suppose you have a website without a meta viewport, and you zoom in on that, and you try to read out the zoom factor, you will still get the zoom factor relative to the ideal viewport, which currently does not play any role in your web project whatsoever. That does not make any sense whatsoever, but it's still how Apple implemented it and how all other browsers followed Apple. Because remember, this is an Apple invention. All of this, what I'm showing you, and it's also a very real problem, but it's weird around the edges, and all other browser vendors have copied it literally, including the weirdness, because they have to be compatible with the iPhone. In practice, what's happening here is not only setting the initial zoom level, but also setting the layout viewport dimensions to the ideal viewport. Again, just like the previous line of code this did. To me, that does not make sense, but all browsers do it, and you can safely use it in your production code. Gets even weirder when we change the value here. If you say initial scale equals 2, in theory, it tells the browser to zoom into 200%, which means that the CSS pixels become twice as large and twice as few fit in the screen, right? On an iPhone, you used to have 320 CSS pixels. When you say zoom into 200%, these CSS pixels stretch up to twice the size, and only 160 fit on the screen. That is normal, but what's not normal is that the iPhone now sets the layout viewport to 160 pixels as well, half the ideal viewport, and nearly all other browsers do that. And that kind of blew my mind, and I totally did not understand what they were doing here. I'm kind of assuming Apple doesn't really know what it's doing either, but maybe there's a deep reason hidden somewhere and nobody's been able to find it. Or maybe it's a report, you know, that's in a drawer somewhere and it's been lost for 8 years. And in there is the real reason why they did it, but everybody's forgotten. Something like that, I don't know. And it's weird. Yes, I said that before, I'll say it again. This is totally weird and I do not understand what Apple is doing. Now comes the fun part. The fun part of doing this kind of fundamental browser research is to mess up browsers. Once you have found a rule, or better yet, a set of rules, you are going to try to confuse browsers and try to figure out what they do next, because sometimes it will teach you something interesting about the browsers. So what I did was write a test with this. Now I'm giving the browser conflicting instructions. Because first I say, okay, please make the layout viewport 400 pixels wide. And then I say, you know, never mind, make it as wide as the layout viewport. Which is the weird reaction browsers have to this bit of code, which actually doesn't tell you anything about width, but never mind, we just talk about that. Set the layout viewport width to 400%, or no, wait, set it to the ideal viewport anyway. What do browsers do now? When I wrote this test, I expected browsers to be all over the place. I expected, you know, to make this nice compatibility table where I showed how the 27 different browsers did 27 different things with this bit of code. Turned out that was not the case. Turned out all browsers do exactly the same. They react by taking the highest value. They compare the two values and take the highest one. Again, all browsers do this. You can safely use it. So what I'm basically saying here is, dear browser, please set the layout viewport width to either 400 pixels or the ideal viewport width, whichever of the two is larger. And even better, please readjust when you change your screen size. When you change the orientation of your device. Which essentially means that this is a way of giving the layout viewport a minimum width of 400 pixels. And now the fundamental question is, what is this good for? And I have absolutely no clue. I just don't know what this is good for. And this is the reason I've been repeating this presentation over and over and over again, because every single time I ask the audience, if you know of an actual practical use case for this weird thing that I uncovered, please come and tell me. This is the 9th or the 10th time I've given this presentation this year. So far, I have heard nothing. If I don't hear anything today, I'm going to assume that this is not does not have any practical application, but it's just one of those weird things that browsers do. So I'm curious. Maybe one of you will come up with something. A minimum width for the layout viewport. That's your homework for tonight. Okay, let's talk about Safari and its totally weird bugs. If you do this, Safari always takes the portrait width. Don't know if you ever noticed, like this, the old iPhone has 320 pixels wide viewport, and thus a 320 pixels wide side. If you change it to landscape, it's still 320. While every sane browser would say, hey, I've got more space now, so I will increase the width of my website to, for instance, 480. The iPhone does not do that, has never done that. The iPad neither. This is definitely something Apple wants to do, but it's the only, Safari is the only browser to do this. And sometimes that's what you want. It can actually be useful at times, but at other times it's just a pain. How can we solve this problem? Fortunately, the solution is extremely simple. You just use the other code. When you use this, 320, 480. On Safari, and all other browsers do the same, except, of course, for Internet Explorer 10, which has exactly the opposite bug. don't applaud me, applaud the guys at Microsoft who thought that was so creative. This example in IE10 gives you the portrait width, even in landscape, but if you use the previous example, the width equals device width, it uses portrait or landscape, whatever is applicable. Okay, so how do we solve the second bug? It's fortunately extremely simple. You just use both. So this initial scale works in Safari, device width works in IE10, and both work anyway in all other browsers. Again, this is specifically IE10. This bug was solved in IE11. The Safari bug has not been solved yet. One point for Microsoft. So this is the perfect meta viewport. Width equals device width, comma, initial scale equals 1. Remember that for your project. Just put this in the head of your document and it will work. I'm guaranteeing it to you because I tested this in 50 browsers. Okay, there's something weird about the meta viewport though. The meta viewport is an HTML tag, right? Because it's got the square brackets, but it's actually telling you something fundamental about the CSS. It has nothing to do with HTML. Which is why Opera proposed to create a proper CSS implementation of the viewport, like this. Meanwhile, it's only IE that supports it. Because Opera used to support it in its old Presto rendering engine, but then, what was it, a year and a half ago, they went over from Presto to Blink, and they lost this particular syntax. IE has implemented it. And then we come to an interesting point. This is the official syntax. It's still prefixed. And this construct gives you the true ideal viewport, while the tag, the meta tag we've been discussing so far, gives you 320 pixels, because iPhone. That is, in Internet Explorer, the meta tag gives you a different result than the MS viewport. And before you think, oh, then Microsoft goes again, no, they do it all wrong and they don't understand. That is actually our fault as web developers, because we were so completely laser focused on the 320 pixels for the iPhone. In fact, there is one device, I think it's a Nokia Lumia 820 that I have, and with a meta viewport tag, it gets a layered viewport of 320 pixels. But with this MS viewport, it gets 364, and the 364 is actually better suited to the device. It gives a more pleasing user experience because the site is slightly wider, which makes sense because the actual device is slightly wider than an iPhone. But still, all the web developers said, oh no, we only think of 320. 320 is all because the iPhone is all and the iPhone is God and we are all so wonderful. And they forgot about other devices. So, besides, they made sure that if you use both the add viewport and tag, that the add viewport overrides the tag. So we arrive at the even perfecter meta viewport that also keeps Windows Phone on board. This goes into your CSS, and this goes into your HTML. And now everything will be absolutely wonderful, and golden unicorns will spring from the sky, and we will be happy forever after. Okay, I have been going on too long already. I'm going to say a few quick words about media queries, because what we've discussed so far is all very interesting, with layout viewports and ideal viewports and meta tags and whatnot. But it's only half the story of responsive design. Once you have actually successfully set the ideal viewport the layout viewport size to the ideal viewport size, so it fits your device, then you have to make sure that your CSS layout actually reacts to that, so that it can figure out what kind of layout you're on now. And that's the job of media queries. I'm kind of certain that you've all seen them before. If you haven't, maybe you should take a quick course in web development or something. There are two important media queries for our current discussion: with and device with. And with is the one you want. If you are currently using device with in your projects, I'm very sorry to inform you that you are doing it totally wrong, for reasons I will explain in a minute. This is device with on a desktop. It gives you the width of the device. Do we care about the width of the device? No, we do not. We do not care a hoot, because what we're interested in is the width of the actual browser window, which is the viewport. That tells us something interesting about what the user is currently seeing and how our website should behave. The width of the device is completely irrelevant to us. Now, the trick is, on mobile, at first it may seem that device width is actually interesting, because on mobile we are interested in how wide the device is. The problem with device width is that in all 50 browsers I tested, everywhere, the device width media query is equal to screen.width. And as we saw earlier in this presentation, there are two competing definitions for screen.width, the ideal viewport and the number of device pixels, and you don't know which one you're going to get. And that is the reason why device width is just flat out wrong. It gives you something completely unreliable. It will work absolutely fine on the iPhone. It will work absolutely fine in Chrome. There are several other browsers it will work in, but it will fail you miserably on the old Android default browser, which still has a larger market share than Chrome. So don't do this. Instead, use width. Width tells us how large the layout viewport is, which is exactly what we want to know. Which is, again, exactly what we want to know. But we don't want a viewport like this. We want to use the meta viewport to put it... Oh, there's not the correct image. I'm going to go on to the correct image. This. Oh. This, right? You use the meta viewport to make the layout viewport equal to the ideal viewport, so that it fits in your device nicely, and then you use the width media query to figure out, okay, so how wide is that layout viewport now, actually? And then you can start to issue specific orders to your layout: do this, do that, don't show the sidebar on the right, but instead show it at the bottom, etc., etc. That is why you should use the width media query and not device width. So, this is why responsive design works. You set the layout viewport width to the ideal viewport width. In theory, you could use another value, right? Width equals 400. You can put that in your meta viewport, but I've never seen a real-world application of that, why you should want to do that. Then you use the width media query to figure out how wide that layout viewport now actually is, and you adjust your CSS. That is how and why responsive design works. You already knew that, but I hope I taught you why it works like it works. Oh, one more thing about media queries: always use min or max width. You want to establish a range. You want to say this particular layout changes should go from width equals 320 to 760 or whatever, but not exactly 320 or exactly 768, because that's far too precise. You have to give a broad range of options. if you ever work with breakpoints, like so defining where exactly your layout should change from, I don't know, one column to two column to three column, don't pay attention to browsers at all. Just take a nice big monitor, show your site as widely as possible, and then start to narrow it down. And as soon as it looks like crap, you know that you have to insert another breakpoint. That's how breakpoints work in responsive design. In particularly, do not stare yourself blind on the 320. First of all, it doesn't even work in the most modern iPhones. And secondly, it leaves nearly all phones out of the question. Okay, so this is responsive design. There's one more thing about responsive design I'd like to say. It especially crept up in the early years of responsive design. We were figuring out what is good for and what we want to do with it. We would like to make our designs respond to the physical width of the device as well. For instance, it could conceivably be useful to make sure that the navigation of your website is at least 25 millimeters wide. And by that, excuse me, by that I mean 25 real millimeters wide, as measured with a ruler on your screen. And I'm here to tell you that you can't. There is absolutely no way in CSS or JavaScript to find out anything about the physical dimensions of your device. And in order to understand why, we have to briefly talk about CSS units. With 25 millimeters does not mean 25 millimeters. Instead, it means 94.488 pixels. Exactly, 94.488 pixels. Because centimeters, millimeters, and inch are fake units. They do not correspond to anything in the real world. What's going on here is that in CSS, 1 inch is defined as 96 pixels. If you don't believe me, create a div with a width of 96 pixels and one with a width of 1 inch, and they will be exactly equal in size. Even better, zoom in on those divs, and the CSS pixels becomes larger, and your inches become larger as well. It's 96 pixels, exactly. These are the official definitions of the various CSS units. The pixel is the root unit for CSS, and the rest is derived from that. I used to dislike this whole thing. I used to think that it would be kind of cool to say, okay, I want to make sure that whatever else the user does, my website navigation will remain tappable. That is, the links will have a minimum width and height, but I kind of changed my mind. Not for any fundamental reason, but for thinking through what that would mean for a browser. If an element would have a real width of 25 real-world millimeters, that would mean that as soon as the user zooms in or out, the browser has to recalculate the size of that element all the time. And you're zooming a lot on mobile. You go in, out, scroll out a bit, in a bit. And that just eats far too much processor time and battery life. And that is why the mobile browsers will never, ever do this. And I have meanwhile convinced that they're right here and that we shouldn't do this. A last ditch hope for some would be, doesn't resolution tell us something useful? No, it does not. Resolution, as well, has nothing to do with the physical resolution of the site. In many mobile ads where they talk about their new devices coming up, and yeah, it has, 384 dpi here, and 529 dpi there, and 847 dpi, whatever, I don't follow it, I don't understand. They are actually talking about how many physical pixels on the device fit in 1 inch. Which is an accepted way of measurement in the graphical industry. So there's nothing wrong with it. It just doesn't have anything to do with web development. Because for resolution, we have this JavaScript, window device pixel ratio, and these media queries. You need this one for the WebKit-based browsers and this one for all other browsers, but never mind that. You have this. And you maybe want to use this. And it's actually useful for responsive images. But what does device pixel ratio actually mean? I found that out as well, and I'm going to tell you, because I like talking about my own research. What is device pixel ratio? It turns out, again in all browsers, that it's the ratio of screen size and device pixels and the ideal viewport size. This goes for all mobile browsers. The desktop browsers, unfortunately, are doing weird stuff here that I don't like and I really have to figure out. But never mind that, we're talking about mobile now. So let's take a look at the iPhone 3G again. It has 320 device pixels. Its ideal viewport is also 320, which means that its device pixel ratio is 1. Simple. iPhone 4S, 640 device pixels, 320 ideal viewport still, so its device pixel ratio is 2, right? Samsung Galaxy Pocket. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. It's a fairly tiny, fairly crappy Samsung phone that I bought, especially because as a mobile web developer, you should have access to fairly tiny, fairly crappy Samsung phones, because a lot of people actually use those phones. So I did my tests on that phone, and I found out that it has only 240 device pixels, but its default browser has an ideal viewport of 320. Why 320? By now you should know the answer, so I'm not going to tell you. And its device pixel ratio is 0.75, which is kind of odd, but it's not wrong. Incidentally, on this same device, I'm running an Opera Classic, and its ideal viewport is only 240, which I think makes much more sense on the device because it's really tiny. And therefore, its device pixel ratio is 1. The device pixel ratio is a function of both the device and the browser. That's important to remember. Let's take a look at the BlackBerry Z10. It has 768 device pixels, and its ideal viewport, as we saw earlier, is 342, which gives us this device pixel ratio. Yeah, you're laughing now. Let's go to the next example. It's weird, but not wrong. The iPhone 6 Plus has 1080 device pixels and an ideal viewport of 414, which gives it this device pixel ratio. That's funny. Especially because they're lying about it. They're saying it is 3, but that is a bug. That is a lie, a bold-faced lie by Apple. It is, as far as I know, the only device that doesn't actually obey my nice, beautiful theory of what device pixel ratio is. And if somebody touches my theories, I get mad at them. So I'm now officially mad at Apple. It's just being taped. You have been warned. This is a bug. Okay, we have reached the end of my presentation. If you want to get more information about this subject, I'm kind of realizing that I go through a lot in a little time, and that some of you people who are not as conversant in CSS as you should be may have difficulty to follow you. Be happy, I have written a book. And there's an entire chapter on what I just told you, and you're all required to buy a copy because I badly need money. That was my presentation. Thank you so much. I will put the slides online and will now take questions.